is that what I want you to understand is right now is that God has assigned an angel over every individual that's born. The moment you're born, there's an angel that's on assignment that protects you, that watches over you. Because Satan is an imitator, Satan has dispatched a demon to be with you too. You remember the TV shows they used to have, and they had the angel on one shoulder and the devil on one shoulder? They really knew what they were talking about. And so that's why the good you would do, evil's always present. As sane as you possibly can be, there's always a door that you might open up and sin. Because Satan always has a demon assigned to each and every one of you. Y'all think what I'm saying? The thing that you have to understand is that angels have personalities. Angels are not forces. They are not a force of power, but they are individuals who possess a personality. The word of God refers to them possessing all the capacity, and personality. According to Psalms 148:2, the Bible says the angels worship God. And this is a volition act showing us that they possess a will. Angels worship God because they know God, and they possess the capacity of knowledge. That's why Jesus says in Matthew 24:36, but of the day, the hour, no man knoweth, not the angels of heaven, but my Father. He says this because angels, they have knowledge. They understand stuff. Hebrews 1:14 says that angels were created to minister. So God's created angels to minister. They are referred to there by apostles as ministering spirits who are sent forth to minister to those who shall be heirs of salvation. The Bible says that when Jesus was in the garden and he was praying, that an angel came and encouraged him. Even Jesus had an angel assigned to him. Amen, somebody. So angels are servants. Catch this now. Angels are servants, and while they may be different ministries, angels as a class were created to administer the will of God. Their job is to administer the will of God. And God executes his will on earth through angelic beings. Angels supervise the life of all men, and they preserve those who are to be the heirs of salvation. They are often instruments to bring divine judgment upon the earth. So Psalms, I want to back up what I'm saying to you about being assigned angels. Psalms 34:7 says, the angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him. The angel of the Lord encampeth around them that fear him, and he delivereth them. Psalms 91:10-13 says, there shall no evil befall thee, neither any plague come nigh by thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways, and they shall bear thee up in their hands. Psalms 103:21 says, bless ye the Lord, all ye his hosts. Hosts are angels. He's the Lord of hosts. He's not the Lord of Israel. He's the Lord of hosts. He's the Lord of all created beings. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. And so his ministers, the Bible says, he says, bless the Lord, all ye hosts, ye ministers of his that do pleasure. So the thing that you got to understand here as I move along is that Satan he's imitating God. So the imitation is the act of using someone or something as a model. It's an act of imitating a person's speech or mannerisms. It's a thing intended to stimulate or copy. So when we look at this word again, wiles, we have to remember that wiles literally means deceit, a trick, a stratagem intended to ensnare or deceive or also beguiling. Satan imitated everything in heaven. The Holy Spirit, we have God has sent us the Holy Spirit. Satan has sent a wicked spirit. So you can be possessed by the Holy Spirit, or you can be possessed by a demonic spirit. Ministering angels, binding demons. God sends ministering angels to minister unto us. Satan sends demons to bind us. Think about that. Everything that God does, the enemy's imitating and doing something different. So when God said that it was good, it wasn't good for man to live or be alone, and he created him a helpmate. He created him a female. So God made male and made him in his own image and in his own likeness, and then he pulled out of male a womb man, a man with a womb, and said that you two should come together and you should make children, you should be fruitful and multiply. Amen. Satan says that, okay, that this is what God says is family, but I'm going to pervert this and I'm going to put two womb mans together and I'm going to let Sarah and Samantha come together and one will play mommy and one will play daddy, and I'm going to make the world system accept this type of lifestyle. Oh, wait a minute, what about Bill and Frank? I'm going to take Bill and Frank and I'm going to make them mommy, one be mommy and one be daddy, and I'm going to make books and I'm going to put them in kindergarten, I'm going to put them in first grade, I'm going to put them in third grade school. And I'm going to make little kids begin to accept that it's okay for two men to be a husband and a wife. But that's not what God said. And so you have to understand the pattern. You got to understand the pattern. Am I losing y'all, young people? Are y'all listening to me? Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth? 1 Corinthians 11:3 says this, but I would have you know.
That's right.
That the head of every man is Christ. And the head of the woman is the man. And I said, and the head of the woman is the who?
Man.
And the head of Christ is God. So I want to do a sermonic illustration today. And I got somebody that's gonna be playing a son and a daughter. If that's you, come up here real fast. Son and daughter, if you haven't already chosen to be that, thank you very much for moving quickly. Yeah, praise the Lord. Sit down, son, sit down, daughter. So, God blesses you with a family and gives you a son and a daughter. Satan does not like you reproducing people to be like you. Malachi talks about the whole intention for God to create man and woman was for them to procreate godly people. Your objective is to, because see what you got to understand is this, when these children are from 1 to about 5 years old, they listen to everything their parents say. From 1 to 5, whatever you really want to impute in them for the rest of their life, that's the best time to program them. Because at that point, to them, you're God. You're God. My mama said, my daddy told me, and everything you tell me, and you can be anything you want to be, son. Baby, you so beautiful, you so smart, you could be the first female president. What you say to them at a young age is so important. And also what you teach them.
Amen. Amen.
So if you teach them to respect you, then that's how they'll follow through.
Amen.
If you teach them to honor other adults, that's what they'll do. At that very young age, they're very impressionable until they start getting into the community of people their age. And the moment they get into the community of people their age that have opinions and have been brought up differently, they're going to begin to share with them what they see, how they see things. And if they're not strong in their convictions of what they know is right, they'll be swayed. So Satan at a very early age will send a serpent to talk to these two individuals. Now where's my mom and my daddy at? My mom and my daddy, who's the mom and dad? Where they at? Come on. Because I need one to stand on this chair and another one to stand on that chair. Yep, that chair. Yep. Okay. So, yeah, be careful. Turn around this way. Daddy? Mommy. Now, hold it up like a 10. Hold it up like a 10 if you can. Okay, so now, the head, the Bible says, the head of every man is Christ. The head of every woman is man. The head of Christ is God. The head of children are their parents. God loves us so much, He's given us 3 layers of covering. He's given us 3, and the first covering you receive is from your parents. And as a woman, there's certain things she's not going to be able to give these two kids. He has to do it.
That's right.
And there's certain things as a man, he's not going to be able to give these two kids. She gonna have to do it.
Yes.
And the devil would make him think he don't need her, and the devil make her think she don't need him.
Yes.
And that's why we got all these individual, independent. And now you mad at your baby daddy because he dogged you. Now you don't want him in that child's life. And God's intent and pattern and plan was for a child to have a father and a mother. I warn you, I may offend you today. But I'm giving you what God has shown me.
Yes.
And so they're covered by their parents. He in his house is like God. She, like Jesus, is the church.
Amen.
Wow.
Amen. That's
he sets the rules, she enforces them. They have to honor everything they say.
Yes.
And as long as they stay up under their covering, they're going to be blessed.
Yes.
The enemy is over here trying to tell them to come up out of the covering. No, Belani, you ain't got to listen to your father. Your father don't know what he's talking about. And see, what he'll do, he'll use some of the same age as her to try to tell her what her parents are saying is wrong.
Oh my God.
And if she's not wise enough, she'll begin to listen to a 13-year-old fool. Wait a minute. You living with your parents.
Right.
You living with your parents. They feed you. They clothe you. They do all that. And how the ham sandwich are you going to convince me to come up out of my covering? And the devil wants you to come up out of your covering. And so they have to hear what their parents are saying. Now here's the reality. 20 years ago, there was a father and a mother in the house all the time. Now that ain't the case. So when you don't have a father and a mother in the home, because of whatever choices you've made, I'm not going to touch that. That's a different message. You still got to work together.
Yes.
But I'm talking about the ones that are in the house together.
Yes.
He's God. He sets regulations. So this is what we're going to do. So this is what we're going to do in our house. We're going to have dinner Monday through Thursday. Sunday through Thursday, we're going to have dinner at 6:30. 6:30, we're going to have dinner. We're going to sit down as a family. We're going to have dinner. Even if I have to work, we're going to sit down and have dinner. She has to say, yes, honey, you're right. That's what we're going to do. So when he's at work, the kids should be bouncing around at 8 o'clock, 8:30. If he said dinner is supposed to be at 6:30, even though he ain't home, she's supposed to honor him and still do it. So whenever he sets rules at the house, it has to be honored even when he ain't there. What women do sometimes is, oh, that's okay, he ain't here. We gonna let him do what they want to do. And that's why kids don't respect their parents. Because in order for them to honor them too, she must honor him.
Thank you.
Amen.
He must honor her. Can I get a witness in here? And see, this is important. And y'all ready for this pattern? Listen to what I'm saying to you. So this is what God's original intent was. Male, he created male. And when he created male, he had them working.
Come on.
So ladies say, if I'm going to find me a male, he needs to be a working male.
Amen.
All right? I'm talking to the single sisters.
Come on, Bishop. Teach us.
So he was a working male that had a relationship with God. Single ladies, stop going after men that don't know God. Oh, I put this up on him. He gonna want Jesus, yeah, sure, okay. And he done had a whole bunch of booty, and that ain't made him run to Jesus. And what makes you think your booty gonna make him run to Jesus?
Hey, Bishop.
And married women that have husbands that ain't saved, you should be the main ones talking to single women saying, girl, whatever you do, don't marry that Negro if he ain't saved. Working, husband covering.
Yes.
See, the problem sometimes is you marry a man that don't know how to cover you.
Jesus, help us God.
Ain't nothing worse than marrying a man that wants to act like a boy. A husband covers his family.
Yes.
If he got to work two jobs to provide for his family, that's what he gonna do, because he gonna cover them.
Yes.
Yes, he gonna see how say, Mackenzie, baby, listen, I know you're real close to that girl, Deja, but I don't like her spirit. And every time she comes over here, she don't even acknowledge me. She don't say hello. She's always going in my refrigerator. She's disrespectful. I don't like that spirit. She can't come over here no more. And Mackenzie got me to say, yes, Daddy. Yes, Daddy. But if her mama, when Daddy ain't home, lets her do whatever she want to do, she going to be like, all right, whatever. And when Daddy ain't home, she'll do whatever she wants to do. Because the mother has instituted that seed of rebellion. So the father is the male, he works, and he has a relationship with God. He's the husband, he covers his family spiritually, financially, mentally. He covers them in every area of their lives. He's the one, he's the first one that tells his daughter she's beautiful. He's the first one that tells his son, you can make it. Come on, somebody. The father is the provider and the protector.